who Rodolfo Sacramon, who's our second speaker ever for Startup Grind Miami. They're having a big product launch today. So their first product was basically an app where you can display advertising on an iPad and slide it into a backpack that they give you with a window in it. And face that backpack out, and as you walk around, you have ads on your back and the advertising. But their advertisers wanted to know, well, how many people actually saw that? So then they made some technology to use the video camera on the iPad to count eyeballs, connecting to the iPad. And they realized, well, there's a big industry around outdoor display advertising, and if we can help them quantify what they're doing, maybe that's where we should focus, instead of trying to be another one of them. And my dad would always tell me a story and tell me that, you know, the people that made the most money in the gold rush were not the miners. It was those who supplied the miners with tents and jeans and mining supplies. So I think they took a similar mentality there and made a pivot and went into building a beacon that counts eyeballs, connecting with an advertiser. That got them in the Internet of Things business, and they realized how difficult it is to make Internet of Things devices, to make a platform that this device is going to speak to. And now what they're launching today, and we'll be talking about, and you guys should check out the news on it, is an Internet of Things platform. And that's all I know right now. They've been in stock, like, stealth mode for a while. But from what I understand, they're building a platform. So if you want to build an Internet of Things product, you could maybe use some of their hardware, some of their software to actually get your device to connect to the Internet and communicate and send data back and forth. So that's at Mobilize. They're launching that tonight. Hopefully, you know, that is great, and they're doing a Kickstarter campaign as well, so check that out. See, if you ever come speak here, you get free plugs for life. speaking of plugs, I want to make sure and plug Google for Entrepreneurs. They are our global sponsor, so besides having a recognizable logo next to ours, that may have been the reason you came here for the first time. They also give us some money to help with operations at the headquarter level. Locally, we're funded by the Knight Foundation. Touch base with Matt Hagman early on, 2 months before we had our first event last May 2014, and told them what we were doing. He said, "That's great, I want to help you out, just send me a proposal." And they funded us within 2 weeks. And you know, their focus, and we're going to talk a little bit about it tonight, is to put in the seed capital for plans that can become sustainable. Not something where they have to continue to put in money and money and money. So if you've got an idea and you're thinking about getting it funded by Knight, that's, I think, a great piece of advice to take into the pitch with you, is show them how you're gonna take that seed money and become sustainable and improve the community and not have to come back to them for money every quarter or every year. Also, we're supported by Moving Picture, and we have Dave Wells, founder of Moving Picture, come up here and tell you a little bit about the company in a minute here. But this video camera is theirs. They do all of our video editing for us as well. South Florida-based company, and they do full production as well as equipment rental. So Dave, do you want to come up here and give a better explanation than I can about it?
I'll be quick. Thanks, Jason.
Sure.
Hi, I'm Dave Wells over at Moving Picture Media. We create original content for companies like Kaplan University, PricewaterhouseCoopers, and many others. We can take your unique story, blend it with your business goals, and develop content that will drive sales. So if anybody would like to talk about video production after the talk, come see me.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you. Not for that speech, but for all that you do for us. So everything that we do is recorded. Dave's team edits that. And then we put it up on YouTube. So if you ever missed one of our events, or if there was a talking point that you want to go back and revisit, that, or you want to share it with somebody, all those are published there. The easy way to get to that content is by going to startupgrind.miami, which leads us into our next sponsor, hello.miami. They are the organization that's leading up really marketing and distributing the .miami domain name. Right now we're standing in the building founded by the founders of .co. They started the .co top-level domain, TLD, and recently the Miami TLD just came out, and hello.miami is the company that's really driving that. So you go to their website, buy the domain from them, support a local Miami startup, and if you're a dentist, you might want to grab dentist.miami, but I assume you probably don't have any dentists. And also wanted to say, give a shout out to Clutch Prep, a company that operates out of here. Got a few clutchers in here. And Alex Gucci from their team helps us with our video production. Tonight he couldn't make it, but he usually is manning the camera, does some of our social media for us as well. And we are looking for additional volunteers to help in social media and marketing. Some of the things that I'd like to start doing by this coming year is to start doing a newsletter, some blog posts covering the events afterwards. I already spoke to Nancy Dahlberg at the starting gate, do a guest blog post over there, and help us grow this to a steady 100 or so attendees. We've had attendance up as high as 130, as low as about 50, and everything in between. And I think that with a little bit of help, and I've got a deep marketing background, so somebody that has very little experience but wants to learn, I can teach, and we can grow this. So if anyone's interested in that, please come see me. Tonight we have Juan Lopez Salisbury from 500 Startups. That's his most recent endeavor, but we're gonna kind of talk about where he started, how he got to where he is now, and he's kind of seen it all. And we're gonna kind of talk about what he's seen and how that's changed his perspective in life over these years. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and invite up with a standing ovation, Juan.
Mainly because of the brand, obviously. But the truth is, you know, it's probably the first event that people have paid for, so it's incredible. So there's a lot of pizza, beer, you know, make sure you take your money's worth of something.
Let's make sure they can hear you first.
Okay.
Make sure you get your money's worth of something. And if you know, if you think this was total waste, go and ask for your money back. You know, I'll take care of it. Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you very much for making the time. I know you're quite busy. You've been transplanted here in Miami, but it's not the first time you've been transplanted into a city. So let's kind of start back the beginning. You're 15, you wanted to see the world, and neither you'll be graduating high school soon, and I want to get out of Argentina. How did that all come together for you?
So it was fun. I think that this might not become extremely relevant for everyone, but to me it was the one thing that I wanted to do. I basically grew up wanting to see a lot more of the world. I grew up in Patagonia, a little south of Argentina, and moved to Buenos Aires when I was 6 years old, and then suddenly I found myself going to school that one day I just decided I wanted to change schools and go to a boarding school that would sort of propel me into going and seeing the world. So basically one day I just went there and enrolled myself for an exam to get a scholarship to get into the school without telling my parents. I started sort of, getting, being tutored at a couple of, there was this math and English exam. I thought I was going to kill it on the English exam. And I thought I maybe needed some help on the math side. I took all these math classes. They really paid off. Like the exam went well, but the English part wasn't that great. So I'm glad I sort of learned my first lesson and got to study a little more. But so bottom line, I moved to this boarding school. I did know my high school, and suddenly, thanks to Argentina, when I was about to leave, things went south. And suddenly that wasn't a reality. Funny part is I started supposedly it was going to be the best university in Argentina to study economics. And 2 months in, I was in this very fancy place, realizing that there were a lot of very fancy restaurants around and the food was great. I had a lot of asados and actually started going to see a lot of classic cars through the afternoon sessions. So I realized that that university was really doing it. And one day I just decided to drop it and started working. You know, it was actually at the time I started working with Epson, a little bit more in the tech industry. I was the youngest guy there in the headquarters, being the pet of a few of the folks there, just having a lot of fun. And throughout the process, I just went into this office for exchange programs in Argentina, where no one would actually take an exchange program. I don't know why. And this guy was like, feet up on the desk, like pretty much playing darts. And I got in there, and the guy's like, hey, what's going on? There's someone here. So I got to ask him about what kind of possibilities I had in terms of going somewhere. And he got all excited, and he was like, you can go to Germany. I'm like, basically German. I don't want to go to Germany. It's full of Germans. And so he's like, you can go to France. And I'm like, France, it doesn't sound like what I want to do. And suddenly this guy says, we got this thing in Sweden. No one ever went to Sweden. I'm like, I'm curious, what's in Sweden? I went home and went to Sweden.com. And it was funny, Sweden.com actually said, hey, we're not Switzerland. And so, they kind of knew where I was coming from. And 3 days after, the guy calls me. He's like, "Hey, you know what? You just got accepted to Sweden." I'm like, "Oh, I never applied. Why are you telling me?" He's like, "Hey, you got accepted. They're expecting you in 3 months. If you want to go? You got a spot." So yeah, moved to Sweden. And I was supposed to be there for 3 months, a month and a half in, and decided I wanted to stay. Transfer all my credits, got accepted as a Swedish regular student, decided to stay there. I think the crazy adventure started was that it took me 5 years to go back to Argentina.
And what were you doing there in Sweden besides going to school?
So, funny enough, when you're named Juan, you don't really have high expectations of people getting to know you at all. it's like, being the John Doe that people know as John. It's just not. So, basically, I started becoming the Juan. So I think the Juan and only started there. Because, all of a sudden I was in this small city in Sweden, 100,000 people. People would start to recognize me as Juan. It's like, Juan. Yeah, I know Juan. Of course I know Juan. And it's like, great. So all of a sudden, within months, I was doing some crazy stuff, like introducing neighbors to each other and throwing parties for 300 people that were all solely invited by me. So it was a fun period of time. And actually, the beauty of it is that I really went to Sweden because it was the furthest, the most different thing I could find to what I was used to. Wow. So it was a learning in every corner. And it was beautiful. And funny enough, one of my best friends at the time was actually studying in Switzerland, in a country where you see a lot of extreme wealth and a lot of different things. And this was sort of a university where excess was everywhere. And I was in a country that pretty much leveled everyone. Mm-hmm. And I think that, when I look backwards, it really taught me a lot in terms of how the value of wealth is really about sort of just being okay with it and not really trying to be extremes.
Okay. So at an early age, you started kind of planning and sculpting your life. I mean, a lot of kids that age would have just been like, I'll graduate, I'll figure out what I'm going to do then. I'll go to college, after I'm done with that, I'll figure out what I'll do then. And you kind of started just planning your life out.
I never knew what I wanted to do with my life, what I wanted to do with my life. I always knew sort of the kind of experience that I wanted to have in life. And I think that this pretty much connects with the generation in which I'm part of. I was just a couple of weeks back, I was at this fintech event, telling people about millennials. Suddenly it became a thing, let's try to understand millennials. And the truth is, it doesn't take a ton of deepness to really understand millennials. It's just about talking to them, really understanding what's been happening through their lives and what they want to do. A big part of it is that I always knew that, goods were never, to me, as good as experiences. So I always knew that I wanted to get to know different things, I wanted to experience different things. And traveling, to me, has always been the key to experiencing the most, and I have to say that languages have also been something to me that's been key in being to not only experience things, but actually being able to connect with those experiences at a different level. mean, eventually, even from Sweden, I decided to take an exchange here in Barcelona. It's a Swedish exchange student called Juan. So suddenly, this Swedish Juan guy comes to Barcelona, and people are like, "So, you know, sure, teach us some Swedish." I'm like, "Oh, you know, I know very few words." But yeah, I can talk Spanish too. So it became a thing. And I finished off my school there, and I still wanted to see more and do more. Funny enough, I worked at a, you know, when you're a student, you do anything and everything. And I worked at an event to, you know, I was the second guy to, I was the assistant to the second guy to Ecclestone, the Formula One race. So I was right in the kitchen, Barcelona. And believe me, that's one of the most interesting experiences I've ever had in my life. Because, you know, Formula One is just something else in terms of experience. It's not just the engines, everything of the flesh. It's the power of everything that just happens around you. It's incredible. And so I decided that was my thing. I wanted to move to that world. I tried to get into that world from so many different places. And so I decided I was going to move to Switzerland and try to find my way in. And my mind, if I would go to Lausanne, where, you know, FIFA was there, and UEFA was there, the Olympic Committee was there. That was my way into the sports marketing world. And so I was in Barcelona making phone calls to say, "Hey, you know, I'm coming there tomorrow. I don't even know what to do. You know, hopefully enough, I'll get closer." And you know, my other phone rings, and they're calling from Madrid saying, "Hey, we'd like to." It was like a Thursday. They're like, "Hey, we'd like to call you for an interview Monday. Like, you know, someone else referred us to." Refer you to us, and we'd like to get to meet you. You know, we've been training the whole week. And on Friday, we pass sort of an exam, or, you know, an interview. We would hire you on the spot. Like, wait a minute, what are you guys gonna do? And so it was like branding reports for countries. You know, living out of a suitcase, traveling the world, representing New York Times, The Economist, Independent, International Tribune. I'm producing this branding campaign, so talking to the most influential and affluential folks in the world in a very fast-paced manner. And like in a week's time, I was supposed to move to Switzerland. In a week's time, I was actually in Greece, sort of being sent to Athens for some time, and that evolved very quickly to, you know, going from Athens to Nigeria, to Guatemala, to Mexico, to Peru. And all of a sudden, you know, it's just literally living out of a suitcase.
So you're branding countries.
Yeah.
How old are you at this
one? I was like 23, maybe. And suddenly I was sitting with the president of a country, and the ministers, and I told you this thing, you know, like I was, you know, in Mexico at one point, I was at a big event, and it was all very, there was a lot of pressure to getting the real people, and then of course getting money out of them to pay for this report. So at some point in Mexico, I was there with all this, you know, very, very important, very well-protected governors, but you would never be able to get close to them unless you find the perfect time. And I see this guy going into the restroom, and I say, "Hey, no, there's not going to be any better time to find this guy with lower defenses." And there I am, taking a pee next to the guy. And, you know, in the middle of it, I'm like, "Oh, this is my time. Hi, how are you doing? I'm Juan." Yeah, I realized the hand wasn't the most important thing there. So never mind, let's talk. So I got an interview, I got a lot of, you know, finding the restroom with his arms.
You met BLC?
Yeah, but, you know, we landed the interview, and I don't remember yet now if we got money out of him, but you know, it was an interesting time because, you know, there was a lot of adrenaline to move to London, to a country, and then just having to make an agenda of the most important people in the country within weeks. Within a couple of months, you know, you have to be sitting with the president, you have to be sitting with the ministers, you have to be sitting with presidents and chairmen of the most important companies. So I think in a way that was a great school to really, you know, lose a lot of respect for titles and positions and a lot of things that, you know, a lot of times that really sort of hold us up. I'm gonna say something as stupid as, you know, even, you know, boost your confidence to even, you know, want to talk to any girl. You know, like something that, it's just, you realize that whatever you want to do is just, it's within your reach.
Yeah.
When you do that, I think for an entrepreneur, for an investor, for a business person, It's just, it's a great school.
Just gotta take that step.
Yeah.
And so you get back home to Argentina.
Well, I was in Peru and I realized that I wanted to have a pillow of my own. So I decided I was gonna take 2 months off. I decided I was not gonna find a job, or I wasn't gonna find anything that would be the next step until that those 2 months of pure holiday came through. And you know, from a post on Facebook from a group of people who actually were working with this company before me, they would post a thing there saying, hey, we're looking for people who still want to travel, want to make good money, want to have fun, but you know, they're going to be living in a fake spot. And I was like, hey, sounds pretty much like they're looking at me. So I just sent a message, and within those 2 months, I got hired to go to a startup and work with them in London, being a regional director for what sounds to many people the best job in the world, which is evaluating luxury hotels for a living. So I had to go through this very rough period of time where I would just go and on this spot, shit. It was a lot of fun, and then I hacked it a little bit because I realized that traveling through the week made me meet a lot of people. But if I would get the room for free over the weekend, I wouldn't have to meet the people at the hotel, but I would get to take my friends from different parts of Europe and meet up in the city and have a great time. So I would do my reviews, that part would be covered, but I would have a great time while doing it. So it's a fun period of time until at some point I jumped on a tube after meeting a friend of mine. And this has been my drug, always sort of thinking about what else could be there. And so I realized that in a way that wasn't fulfilling enough. And so I decided, I wanted to do an NGO. I mean, I do know why, it's probably for a different story.
Explain that to me.
Well, I think we all have that. I was telling you about this tension of two things. When I went to school, there was this Spanish class that would all be about literature, and it was always about this tension between passion and sort of rationale. And it was so easy at some point. They would say, "So what's the book about?" Well, the tension between passion and rationale. Whatever book it was always about that part, right? So I could pretty much not read it, but if I would bring that up, I would have some points. And so I realized that if I had to translate this to my own life, there's always a tension between lifestyle and sort of that aspect of contribution and what we really bring up to and we really create for the world. And when I speak about lifestyle, it's not really about I drive this great car and I wear this great clothes, but really how we want to live our lives. What we want our Mondays to look like, what we want our Tuesdays to look like, even what we want our holidays to look like. And I think we all have different definitions for that, but it's very important that we have an idea of it. And then the other side of it is sort of, what kind of contribution do we want to bring to the world? And we talked about it a little bit before, and we all know about Mother Teresa, we're just not all ready to be one. We all recognize the value in it, but we just, I think we all want to make those kind of sacrifices. And so that path to sort of becoming a hero, from zero to hero, has a space in between, and at some point we just feel okay with the balance.
Yeah.
I think we all try to find the balance. And I felt that I had to go a little bit more into the contribution side. So when I thought about this NGO, I actually thought about something called, at the time, the Oyster Effect, where I basically came to the concept that we all sort of been given a lot of opportunities in life, and everything we have in life has been a part of an opportunity. And those opportunities in the majority of times, would go as far as saying that probably in 100% of times, they were given to us. Someone has given us the opportunity to do something. And I'm not saying we weren't responsible for that to happen, but then someone else has really been there behind us and actually opened a door for us. And I thought that there's got to be in ourselves, first of all, a great sense of gratefulness about it, and recognition. And at the same time, there's got to be a way that we can pay it forward. Mm-hmm. And And so I decided I wanted to go out to the richest people in the world and basically say, you know, this you know, please, you know, just go through the course of enlisting those probably the three key opportunities you had in life. Most of them always have to do with education. And so once you enlist those, you know, let me, you know, give me funding for those, and let me just pass them on to someone else. It's usually what you do to your son, naturally. And so what I would do is actually go find the best possible son for that to happen. So not only, you know, find you someone to do it, but actually find someone who will take the best possible advantage of it. So I went home with that idea in mind, was totally convinced it was going to be the thing. And everybody starts like, boo, you know, what are you going to live out of? You know, what do you want to be, Mother Teresa? You know, make some money before you want to do that. And so I realized that, well, I didn't realize, I thought that they were maybe right. And I decided to do something much more profitable, which was building a startup. And so all of a sudden, I put all my savings in. I went completely broke. And I started producing videos for a platform that I thought had a great level of contribution, which was basically an online TV show where we would talk about politics, economics, and social problems. But like through the main, sort of the main people in Argentina at the time. I was doing this with a partner of mine. It started off very well, you know, we're all very excited, and all of a sudden I come back, you know, sort of looking at the numbers, and I realized that there were two main learnings I was getting out of it. The first one, that we needed to do some sort of more digestible content, something a little more fun. And the second thing is that there were a lot of independent producers sort of going through the same thing, but they needed a platform. They needed some help with the commercial aspects of it, where we could, you know, come all together and build something together. So I came to my partner and told him that, and he told me, hey, well, you know, I've earned my fair share as well, and, you know, my main outcome of it is that I don't want to do this anymore. You know, well, thanks for the encouragement. So then I started a cooking show. Love cooking, so it's a good way to do it. And I started the platform. And so that's where Donde Quieras TV, a platform that, you know, if I have to go back now and look at it, you know, I never got the traction that I wanted or would have wanted to have with it. But it definitely served its purpose of teaching me a lot of things and how to be a sole founder, basically how to not be a sole founder. And basically it took me to the next step, which was, you know, a day a friend of mine comes in and says, hey, you know, I see you're hustling with this platform by yourself. Why don't you come and meet this guy from Uruguay that I've been doing business with? That's new to let's go to Montevideo for a day and you get to see what they're doing. I think there's a lot of things you can, you know, get inspired by. And suddenly I see this office with 25 people working, you know, after I've been in my apartment by myself, jumping and crying. I said, hey, you know, this all sounds like a great story and a dream come true. Start talking about what they were doing. They were doing mobile games. Of course, I knew absolutely nothing about mobile games. But you know, all of a sudden, I just wanted to be a part of it. So they tell me, so, you know, this is what we're doing. We're going to do planning our next hit. Of course, we never had actually a hit before. But, you know, I bought into this idea that the next hit was actually going to be the one. And so they talk about football and a lot of things that, of course, in that town, you know, they seem great. So I say, hey, so, you know, what do you need? What do you need to do it? And they're like, well, we need investment. I'm like, well, how much? Oh, we need 50K. Okay, great. So do you need 50K or do you want 50K? Like, well, you know, we could do it with 25. I'm like, well, that's great. Let me go back to Argentina and find your investment. That just met them like 2 hours ago. These guys were like, you know, who the hell is this? This little Argentinian.
Juan.
So I go back to Argentina, and of course I had pitched a fund in Argentina about Donde Quieras TV, and they basically told me, you know, we'd love to fund you. We'll find a team, come back, and we'll invest in you. So I went there, you know, with my one pager and said, hey, you know, I got the next big thing. Of course, to me, the next big thing was working with like 25 people. To me, it was, again, the dream come true, and my passport to happiness and eternal love. We got the investment. I got to jump in full time with these guys. I got another friend of mine there. The friend who took me there, you know, he said, I'll pitch in with a couple of thousand as well. So all of a sudden, we were this team working together. It was, I felt it was, you know, top of the world. I could even hear the song, I'm on top of the world. And so all of a sudden I was there, and you know, what I realized is that within the next 4 months, I actually learned a ton about mobile games, or what I thought was a ton, especially compared to where I was coming from. And you know, leading beta tester groups and doing all sorts of things. But I realized we were having a lot of problems within sort of the team dynamics.
You for 2 hours.
We that's the kind of diligence you do, right? in all honesty, you know, they were great guys, but we just had a different work dynamic. And suddenly I realized that wasn't working for me. And I went back to them and said, you know, I see that there's an issue here. And they were like, what issue? Well, we clearly have a bigger issue than I thought. And so, you know, I was just going through my mind and actually felt very responsible about even that small investment of 25K. I felt extremely responsible for the kind of commitment I took from my investors, especially when, like, you know, it's a matter of trust. It's not really a matter of how much the money is or whatever. But, you know, I think that most people here, you know, if you ever sort of raise money, it's always something that, you know, bonds are there, which you feel responsible for. And so, you know, I felt that my worst nightmare would actually be not if we would, like, not raise the following round, but actually what would happen if I would raise a bigger amount. And then at that level of responsibility would be even higher, and I would not feel comfortable with it. But rather, you know, knowing all this background, then I knew it was not going to work. And so I went back to our investors and I said, hey, you know, I have to, you know, confess that I found the person that I thought was going to understand me the most, understand me the most, and sat down. I was actually devastated, and I just, you know, I was very honest, and I said, well, I don't think this is working. I want to give you a heads up, I'm actually leaving the company. And it felt very weird at the time. So I left. It's funny how a lot of times when you leave something, you're feeling the worst. And suddenly you realize that, you know, maybe all that thing that you're feeling is not that real. It's just that we sort of, I got this thing that I always try to say that success is a self-inflicted illusion. You know, in a way we buy our own story and suddenly we feel great. But in the same way, the opposite happens. So failure is a self-inflicted illusion. And so I felt like failure. And all of a sudden I found all these other companies that were working with, in the batch, that had also received investment from these investors. They were all offering me spots in their companies and say, hey, come work with us and come do this with us. And so it felt great. I mean, it felt that I was sort of a little more valuable than I thought I was. And I started consulting with a few of them. Doing business development, there was this thing that I've been seeing for a while, and I think it's still a thing. It started back there, where I saw that big companies, big corporates, there's a huge disconnection with the startup world. And they both need each other. They just speak different languages. And so I started working with them to help sort of bridge that gap. At that point, you know, one of those days, a friend of mine says, hey, let's, you know, come with me, we're gonna have a drink at a bar with this Mexican dude who just came into town. And I'm like, oh God, I have much better things to do. I'm like, no, come on, you know, it's this guy, you know, I think I'll feel more comfortable if you're there. And I'm like, really? Okay, I'll go. I go into this bar, this guy is there, and she's there, and so, you know, let them be. At the end of the night, actually, I find this conversation happening next to me where this guy was talking to a couple of entrepreneurs that were pitching him, and they were talking about structures of incorporating in a country or another, how to sort of structure a deal. And I knew very little about it, but you know, for some reason I had a strong opinion. So it's probably the alcohol. And I jumped into the conversation. I said, no, you guys are wrong. He's right, you know. You guys hated me, I'm sure. And so we started talking with this guy, and we kicked it off, and we walked home. It was very romantic, it took hands. We started talking, and we realized there were a lot of things that we had in common, that we were thinking sort of in the same way. At the time, this whole, now my blog is called Mind the Gap. It's also an adult code domain, so, And so at the time, this whole thing started to me, you know, like, so there are gaps everywhere. And you mind the gap, you start sort of having to bridge it. Because, you know, once you see there's a gap, there's no coming back. And so we started talking about this, and it evolved to him saying, hey, why don't you, you know, come to Mexico? You know, we're with 500 startups, and we have an accelerator in Mexico for, you know, Mexican companies, and I think that you could provide some value. Still don't even know what kind of value that is, but, you know, might be a good fit. And I said, oh, you know, why not? When do you need me? Oh, in 4 days. Okay, I'll be there in 3. And so I, you know, I left my apartment and everything there just as it was. I called my mom and said, hey, mom, you know, I'm moving to Mexico. She thought I was, you know, drunk on tequila or something. And so, yeah, I did. Moved to Mexico, a month and a half in. Funny fact, you know, fun fact, Rene was there as well, part of the team. We moved into Mexico the same day. He was coming from a different background, different story, but similar context. And so we come in there. I only knew David Lur from online videos and, you know, him swearing a lot on the internet. And so we got there the first day. Dave was there with a bunch of mentors, and we were gonna kick off a sort of an Axel week with a new batch of companies. And so we go for dinner, start talking, and, you know, Cesa, this guy that actually brought me into Mexico, says, hey, yeah, so Dave, so this is these are the new interns. What the fuck? I wasn't supposed to be an intern. And so, you know, I'm being taken to the side and I'm like, Cesar, what's going on? He's like, well, you know, we didn't really have a green light to hire you. So, you know, let's keep it sort of the low line that we'll talk about. And so we were testing the waters. We really wanted to see. And I think that that has actually been one of the best lessons I've had in terms of management. That, you know, coming from a past of jumping into the water after 2 hours of knowing potential partner, there was nothing better than really having a trial period where we could actually get to know each other through a, you know, a set sort of experiment. And this is something, you know, I recommend to every entrepreneur, and something I do right now when, you know, when I start to do stuff with people. Like, you know, let's plan an experiment. Let's plan something that we can do for a couple months, short period of time. We could sort of get to know each other. And, you know, if it doesn't work, that's great. You know, we can keep being friends. But if it does work, then we go and do more stuff together. But, you know, it'll feel more natural. And so, again, you know, this is something I know right now. But, like, at the time, a month and a half went in, and I felt that this was already working. So I sat down with, you know, the whole team, and I said, hey, guys, you know, there were 2 partners at the time in Mexico. And so I sat down at the dinner table. You know, bottle of wine, of course, is every good conversation needs to start. And I say, hey guys, you know, to me this is all in or nothing. So either we partner and go full on to make this something bigger and stronger and, you know, all together, or, you know, I'll just grab my stuff and go home. And, you know, it was, at the time it was all in. And we started what was sort of more of a Mexican operation. We started extending it to the rest of the Spanish-speaking countries, and all of a sudden we were bringing into Mexico companies from Argentina, from Chile, from Colombia, from Peru, from Venezuela, from even Spain, and different countries. And people were just emailing us saying, you know, we love what you guys are doing, we want to come to work with you in Mexico. And it was awesome. That's been sort of the past 2.5 years. Amazing team. We've invested in over 80 companies out of Mexico. I mean, 500, a lot of us know, and if you don't know, I'll give you some context. You know, we've invested in over 1,300 companies worldwide. You know, ticket size is anywhere from, you know, 40,000 to 500K, over 50 countries. So it's been an incredible impact, which is aiming to sort of fund in the long term the top 1% of entrepreneurs in the world. So it's, you know, that's how ambitious Dave's mission is, and that's the kind of monster he's created, which is amazing. And, you know, we were lucky enough to have an operation in Mexico that would cater sort of Spanish-speaking Latin with a program that we defined and we sort of established that was a little bit longer than what we did in Silicon Valley. It was supposed to be the best practice for happening, but we realized that the best practices from Silicon Valley doesn't necessarily apply everywhere. And sort of we took a couple of those things and brought them into the continent. We really needed a lot of more support. So we did a longer program, 4 to 5 months. We helped with everything sort of from incorporation of the company, structuring of the company. You know, all of a sudden I was a professional lawyer, helping companies structure companies with a holding company, subsidiaries, and this is recorded, I'm done. we had help of incredible lawyers that helped us with this, and we would help companies from new incorporation to product design, product development, marketing, finances, fundraising. So it's a very, very complete thing. When companies would come in and get all that and more within a time period of 4 or 5 months. And when we look backwards to that process, we can now see companies that are having annual run rates of millions of dollars, and they have raised hundreds and millions of dollars as well. They're all raised some Series C, and they're looking to raise Series A right now. A couple of very good companies, employing hundreds of people. And so, really, when we look back at what we did those 3 years, and what that outcome is looking forward, just feels amazing. That balance I was telling you about, it actually feels the closest I've ever felt to Mother Teresa, but with a great deal of an amazing lifestyle, because I can't complain about the kind of life we've had the past couple of years. It's been incredible, working with incredible people. Our team there is fantastic, and it still is. We were a strong, very, small, strong team, and having found that has been probably the best thing I've ever done in my life.
Are you guys building companies solely for the VC path?
So, we do. Right, and that's what we do. We raise money from LPs and we invest in companies. But one of the things that I've sort of learned through the process, and I'm very vocal about, is that not every company needs to go through it. What I've learned, and I think that what kind of background everyone has, but if anyone's an entrepreneur, I'm sure that you all have very different paths. Not everyone has raised some money. Some people bootstrap. Some people just wanted to build something that would adapt much more to their lifestyle, and adapted. It was much more designed to build the kind of life they wanted. And we were discussing before about this Basecamp CTO that very recently David put up this post, basically talking about how this unicorn mentality is really driving people insane.
Yeah.
And how all of a sudden, if you're not building a unicorn, you're worthless. I've been trying to be very vocal about the fact that that's not the only way. And I do agree that we should all find that point where we feel comfortable with making a dent in whatever way possible. And it doesn't necessarily, because it's very easy to think that whether if you're not the next Elon Musk, you're a failure. And I don't think that a lot of people here are going to be Elon Musk. And I'm not saying this in a very demeaning way. Probably sure I'm not gonna be Elon Musk myself. I feel like a failure. But the truth is, there's so many other ways to do it, and we all, I think that if we sort of remind ourselves that sense of purpose comes with really finding a reason why we want to wake up and do something that, makes that little dent for wherever number of people we find possible, it's still very valid and very useful. We need more of that.
And you mentioned earlier that your failure is only what you think of yourself as a self-inflicted wound, if you will. And same for success. But what about when you feel like a failure, but you feel like everyone else sees you as a success? And having that that imposter syndrome.
Yeah.
Pressure that can come with that. Hasn't that happened with a lot of entrepreneurs?
Happened with me. Since the beginning I've been with 500. It's a bunch of very, high IQ people chasing the dream. All very nerdy. a lot of times, you're there in Silicon Valley looking around you and you're like, why could, I'm nothing like this guy. So it happens all the time. I think that if it happens to me within the VC industry, and it always happens, it's not just within 500, you go around events and you always feel that the other guy is better than you. Honestly, I would feel worse about feeling that I'm the smarter guy. So I think I'm probably in the wrong room. But honestly, you know, it feels bad. You know, this imposter syndrome, you always feel like you're not in the right place, and you know, when are they gonna ever realize that you're not as good?
Yeah.
And then, you know, it happens with the entrepreneurs. You know, it's always, you know, you're giving your 120%. You're feeling that you gotta go through the race and you gotta move the next big thing, because you know, otherwise TechCrunch is not gonna say that, you know, I'm the greatest new thing and you know, the top 30 and the top whatever, and the, you know, we all need to feel so special. Suddenly we just, you know, buy too much into that. It's always a race and it's so stressful that it becomes a nightmare. And I think that it's very easy for people to just sort of forget what's important. And again, if you sort of come back to it and realize that, you know, you need to generate value. And there's this great post that I was actually reading for totally different, for the wrong reason, or the right reason. But it's a post by Paul Graham from years ago that I actually found this. It was titled, Mind the Gap. So when I saw it, I was like, hey, you know, I'm not that stupid. So I expected to find a lot of my ideas into his writing, you know, to prove my concept. But it had nothing to do with it. But it's an amazing article how he speaks about sort of wealth and money. Now they're very they're very different things. And so, you know, to make a long story short, because he loves to write these crazy long stories. You know, the whole point was, you know, wealth is something we create, and money is just a means for it to transfer from one hand to the other. And so if we as an entrepreneurs, or, you know, people within the entrepreneurial ecosystem, we remind people that it's all about creating that wealth and generating wealth for at least that, you know, might be as big or as reduced as the number of people that we want, but, you know, if we're generating wealth within a community, within a market, it's valid. You know, no one should take that away from you. You know? And I do think that we tend to believe, especially within Latin America and other places, we tend to believe that, you know, we're less innovative than you know, places like South Korea, because look at them, they're creating all these different patterns, and we're not. So if you compare, we're clearly better and more intelligent. And the truth is, you know, I tend to disagree with that, because I think that that's sort of being valued by another value scheme that's being measured by something that's old in the paradigm. It's looking at what 50 years old, you know, behind us have been looking at what success looked like. You know, I have these patterns and I protect stuff. Now it's all about open knowledge and, you know, how we can sort of collaboratively do something better. And we have so many problems within our regions that have nothing to do with pattern science, but they still need solving.
Yeah.
We still have very big problems within the energy sectors, the food industry, you know, health, education. They don't need people who come and reinvent the wheel. They need people who come and put together a wheel and make it turn. So unless we start telling people that it's okay to build the wheel and make it turn, we'll start, you know, ignoring a lot of people very capable of solving a lot of the things that we have around us. So.
Gotcha. And I guess that kind of goes back into this unicorn mentality, where everything has to be unique, original, patentable, protectable.
It needs to be incredible, because otherwise you're a failure.
You suck.
You suck. You suck. And you know, you're not worth $1 billion.
And then you talk about wanting to find the top 1% of entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
I mean, only the top 0.001% will ever become purple unicorns.
Well, even less. And you can't tell the rest of them that they suck.
Yeah.
It's not fair. Yeah. Honestly, like, you know, we need to learn some humanity. It's not fair. And you know, I think that for returns purpose, it's fine if you do less than a unicorn, but even for humanitarian reasons, we shouldn't forget that these guys are people. And they're very valid entrepreneurs, and very valid game changers. They're trying to make their dent. I think it's it's fantastic that we, you know, we give them this adulation. I mean, but this one here was just for show. But yeah.
And let's see, thoughts together.
I met this entrepreneur from Chile a couple of weeks back. I've actually saw him before. This guy is doing a company called Algram. It's very different to what a VC business would look like. But you know, this guy coming from one of the top universities in Chile, the guy realized that there's, you know, he called it the poverty tax. When they, you know, when you go into slums, they don't have enough money to buy sort of a big package of stuff. So they would go and buy, like, you know, small bottle of oil, small amount of food. And so you realize that these guys were overpaying for a smaller package when, you know, like it was a crazy comparison of price, you know, the big thing and the small thing, but they couldn't buy the big thing. And so there was this poverty tax they were paying because they couldn't afford the bigger thing, and so hence they were paying more. And so he decided he was going to start this company where he would have his dispensaries of food in different slums. Where we, you know, he would sort of provide them with sort of the bulk sort of quantity of stuff, and they would have to come with their own recipe, their own recipient, and just, you know, fill it there. But the, you know, this guy had moved. You know, this guy coming from an affluent family, the guy moved into a slum for a year with some of his former college student, you know, college or colleagues. To get to sort of go through the whole experience and see what was it like to live in a slum and what kind of problems they had and how we could change it. So, you know, is that guy going to be a very successful VC-funded company? Hell no. No one in their sane mind would probably fund them, at least from the, you know, from the tech perspective or, you know, that kind of atmosphere that we are in. Because it has nothing to do with what we look for. But is this guy a failure? You know, hat off.
Yeah. And in Mexico, you've been there to see the community, the ecosystem, kind of transition from its infancy into an adolescence, and now getting into its
stages. You know, the funny story there is that, you know, I've been comparing ecosystems to people for some time, and so this way in which, you know, you start and there's nothing there, and you're all kids, and, you know, suddenly you have a couple of kids are born, and you see that evolving to, you know, we start growing, and then we want to do a lot of stuff. You know, we're fun, we come up, we fall, but, you know, the truth is we look forward and we want to do more and more and more and more. We want to learn and do more. We're all in this sort of get you done mentality. And then suddenly we realize, you know, we're coming into puberty and there's a lot of changes within our bodies and we just don't know what to do with them. And we just feel very strange. So it basically started happening in the ecosystems. Once we were at that point, we sort of, you know, we for the first time, you know, we were falling and looking down. Now we're starting to look up a little bit. So we start realizing there's other people, but then we don't even know what to do with our people. It's like, oh, you know, I don't like you. I don't know why I don't like you. And so that's sort of the adolescence. And I think that's the part that happens with ecosystems. You know, we start building all these little dots in different groups. And You don't really have a lot of idea why, but, like, everyone's pointing fingers at each other, saying, well, you know, yeah, they're decent, but, you know, like, look, they got a, you know, freckles. Okay, what is that? How is that a problem? You know, I don't like it. And you see that happening a lot. You know, VCs fighting with each other, very, very competitive, and different groups and different meetings. Like, oh, but you're accelerators, you hate each other. It's like, no, we don't. We're like, oh, yeah, but you do. And sometimes, you know, being extremely transparent, sometimes, like, no, we don't. But, you know, they got issues. And so, you know, at some point you go through that period of adolescence and suddenly you start sort of noticing that your body's not going to change. You know, it's changed already. And you start accepting it. Or you're, you know, I'm okay with it. And so you start realizing that you're good at some things or you're bad at other things. And then a big part of that is accepting the other person. And so when that happens, I've seen ecosystems accepting each other, all these different groups saying, hey, you know, you're not that great, you're not that bad either, but you're actually good at a couple things and we're good at other things. Why don't we start collaborating? And I think that that's got a lot to do with sort of at some point while you go through that maturity period is actually understanding or really sort of trying to bring your mind back to the realization that everyone just, I mean, this applies to everything. people, you know, I'm not saying they're good or bad, but most of the times people just do the best they can. You know? And this applies to friendships, to relationships, to families, and, you know, most importantly, to ecosystems. And so I've seen that at that point, we can really start getting pieces together. And I think that Miami is getting to that point, you know, sort of trying to jump to the other thing I want to talk about. Miami, I think that it involves a lot of people here. But Miami is getting to that point where, you know, we've been sort of hitting each other a little bit, and, you know, I've seen this happening over the last couple of years, different groups really trying to find sort of the dynamics within them. But all of a sudden, it was all about, like, so how are we going to join these dots, and how are you going to make this possible together? And I think that that's where the next big thing is, which is, you know, how are we going to take this to the next point? And we're actually going to take some of this burden off the Knight Foundation, for instance, which has done an amazing job. But, like, well, what happens to the Knight Foundation tomorrow decides to close? I think we have a problem. So the whole point is, you know, what can we do as the next point, so as to bring people together and actually more actively collaborate?
So we kind of start off as infants and excited to learn, and then we get to this point where we become stronger and competitive and start maybe comparing ourselves to others, and that's where you see Miami's kind of right now. We're kind of in that, starting to develop a competitive.
No, I think it's actually starting to get away from that.
Okay.
I think it's starting to mature a little bit more. And it's starting to realize that if this is ever gonna work, it's gonna work with collaboration. Because in any other way, it's just such a small community that we start, you know, hating each other and we start fighting for it, it's just never gonna happen. And so in that direction, I think that probably the next step will be, and at least I'm extremely biased because this is what we've sort of been, a big part of it in Mexico, which is sort of generating a critical mass of startups at the top of the funnel that would allow this thing to move forward and actually bring those thoughts together. You know, the way I would see this is, you know, you got like angel groups, especially here in Miami, you got like angel groups like AGP, you got events like Emerge or Sign, start Grind yourselves, and you got like now these coding schools like Ironhack or Wincode, which are doing great stuff, you know, great things to sort of develop talent. Then you got co-working spaces like Building, you know, this awesome place just opened 2 months ago. And you got, you know, WeWork wanting to do more, and, you know, the lab and a lot of these great spaces have been around for a bit. You got some angels who are sort of starting to do stuff for themselves. A couple of funds, a couple of investors are coming from different parts of the U.S. to, you know, have a deep dive in the scene. A couple of startups scattered around. Trying to do their own thing. And so to me, you know, if I find all these dots around it, to me what's missing is an accelerator right in the middle that will allow a lot of companies to come out of it. Because if you do that, then you generate something that's sustainable, that's generating, you know, 40, 80 companies a year, it's allowing people to come and work together in the middle. Mm-hmm. And so when you're creating that, you're allowing people to, you know, those events to give exposure to these people. You're allowing angel groups to invest in these companies. You're allowing all those funds and angel investors to become co-investors and start working together instead of in different directions. You allow other capital to come into the equation because, you know, honestly, I don't think capital is going to come here before talent and companies. You allow these coding schools to actually produce talent for these companies or either create new entrepreneurs and, you know, generate new sort of classes of people. And at the same time, actually effectively be able to become the catalyzer that should be for companies from not only different parts of the states and different parts of the U.S., but at the same time, you know, Latin America really, really become the hub that we've been talking about for so long. Because the opportunity is here. You know, for instance, for us, this has been a great opportunity to bridge a lot of different things we've been doing. You know, the stuff that we've been doing out of Mexico, with Spanish-speaking Latam, the stuff we've been doing with Brazil and investing in Brazilian companies, the knowledge that we have from Silicon Valley and all the mentoring that we have from Silicon Valley. We can even tap into capital from New York. So we, this is really a point where all these things really just comes together. And, you know, I'm not even starting with saying how, you know, great the quality of life is and a lot of other stuff that made Miami a really special place. But honestly, the, you know, the potential of Miami is tremendous. When you look at how the Hispanic community, the Spanish-speaking people in the U.S. are sort of growing in the next couple of years, I mean, I was seeing some numbers that, you know, like about 50 million people in the U.S. speak Spanish. If you look at that kind of numbers, you know, you realize that this should be the playground for companies in that town that are doing okay to come and kill it and crush it. And if you want to actually get to San Francisco, there's no better way than coming from here. Mainly because if you go to San Francisco, most of the times you're going to get the boot. Now, people are like, yeah, you know, it all sounds very exciting, but, you know, I have all these companies around me. Why do I care about you? And we've seen this happening so many times. And we, unfortunately, you know, there's, it shouldn't be my role to tell companies in that town, don't go to San Francisco. They're not going to care about you. Actually, a lot of the times I'm actually setting expectations rather than saying don't go. I'm saying, you know, just take it easy. When you go there, please don't say you're that disappointed, but actually just enjoy it. You know, try to make the most of it. But when you come back, you know, I'm going to try not to tell you I told you. But I'd rather help you find the next thing. And so the next thing in Latam has always been sort of creating more investors and more of a network for them to actually not having to leave Latam. But the truth is, this doesn't have to be a plan B, but actually a great opportunity. When you can offer them a very easy entry point to the U.S., to an incredible market, where they can be more, you know, more of a culture fit, and you can sort of make them tap into starting a business in the U.S. with a proven traction in the U.S. Even if you can come to me and say, hey, there's not enough follow-on capital in Miami, but you have a business that's doing incredibly good in the U.S., believe me, you're going to go to San Francisco and they're going to treat you differently because you're already in the U.S., you're making a dent here, and you have the numbers to prove it. And if you do that, it doesn't matter whether the capital is going to come from San Francisco, from New York, or wherever that is, or even, you know, Boca, I don't know. But, you know, it's just going to care about you because you're already doing something here in your own backyard. And so that's why I think that Miami will happen. And it will happen regardless of all of us. I'm hoping it happens regardless of the Knight Foundation. And I'm not saying this, you know, in a demeaning way. I'm saying the Knight Foundation has been the fundamental stone of this ecosystem. And they're amazing. But what we need to make sure is that we honor them by making this sustainable beyond them.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I just want to kind of wrap it up here. We're going to go into QA right now. And I think maybe there might be a lot of questions that you might have for Juan, because we may have taken a totally non-traditional path to what you might have expected us to talk about today. But I think that not enough people are...
Probably not a bad path, though.
But I think this is a good path and an important path. Number one, just take a step in the direction. You don't know where you might end up. You don't need to know your final destination. But if you know that's, that you're moving in the right direction, Juan's taking many steps in a direction that he would have never known that he was going to be a partner in an entrepreneurial incubator, accelerator. At some point, and he ended up hopscotching across around the world until he found himself there. If you're not Larry Page, you're not a failure. There are many levels of entrepreneurial success in between there, and you know, you really got to look at what you're doing, and don't try and figure out how you can make what you're doing into the next largest company in the world, but recognize what it is capable of and start setting that as your goal. So once you reach it, you will have reached your goal. You will have been successful in your own degree, and not feel like a failure. And three, that we've got a budding ecosystem. Here, we've got a long way to go, but you know, the longer that we compete with one another, the great thing is that I never talk about WeWork in building and have somebody look at me funny
like, you know, all these co-working spaces are serving their own purpose, whether it's geographic or the types of companies that are there or the style of the architecture or whatever it is that works for certain people. So if all these co-working spaces were to be at each other's throats, it would only hurt the community. So for anyone's competitor in your space, collaborate with them.
And I encourage, you know, people to find their own ways to break their own boundaries. Like, you know, when we in Mexico started realizing that we're bringing all these incredible mentors from San Francisco and different parts of the world, we were paying for, you know, the tickets and hotels and stuff for people who have actually sold their companies for hundreds of millions of dollars. They were spending 3 or 4 days in Mexico City with us, with our companies, just heads down, helping, you know, these entrepreneurs work through their own problems and really get dirty with these entrepreneurs. We realized there was a tremendous amount of value in that thing, but no one else in Mexico City was knowing that this was happening. And so what we did is we picked up the phone and we called Wyra, this other accelerator in Mexico City, where everyone thought we wanted to kill each other. And we said, hey, what if we just take our mentor session to your place? And they were like, what? It's like, yeah, you know, we got this great mentor. Why don't we just take it and do the session there with your entrepreneurs? And it was weird, right? Like, people were looking at us like, you know, isn't that like, you know, cold taking formula to Pepsi? And for us, it made total sense. And once we were sort of the ones taking that step, we saw that it came back, and even bigger, with a bigger impact. And it just kept on going. And you know, when we came here to building, we said we want to do open mentor sessions. And we, you know, we talked to the folks here and we said, you know, we have those sessions here. How about, like, how do you guys feel if we take it somewhere else? And they're like, oh, that's great. You know, let's break these barriers. Let's take this mentor here instead of just doing it in building. Let's just go to the lab. And let's just go to, I don't know, we're doing an event tomorrow on Thursday when we go into like a startup. Mm-hmm. And so we're taking it to Live Ninja, where, you know, Will's been making incredible efforts to bring communities to his place. And maybe next week we're talking to Vice to take it to their office. So we're breaking the boundaries and we're really trying to find the ways we can connect those dots in a way that it feels so ridiculous that everyone else needs to now find their own ways to collaborate with wherever they felt they could never do it. And I think that, you know, I was talking to you before we started and I said, hey, you know, about this whole Larry Page and not Larry Page. Well, you know, I'm honored that I'm here sitting today. I definitely don't consider myself Larry Page, and I'm honored that, you know, you guys are here. If there's one thing I could probably talk about is the kind of stuff that, you know, the kind of reflections I've had in the last 10 or 15 years of trying different things, the kind of things that I sort of thought about and the kind of conversations I've had with other people and myself to try to, you know, teach myself something. And if I could share that with anyone else that, you know, really takes a bit of this with them, incredible. And if not, you get your money back.
So, if you've got a question, please raise your hand. We'll go through a few questions. Yeah, if you're a CEO of a startup and you're about to start funding, what steps do you take to get ready to raise funding?
I mean, that really depends on the conditions of your company, right? There's probably one thing that you need to know, and it's, you know, that fundraising is hard, wherever that is, wherever you are. Some people think that, you know, because they're here, it's going to be hard, because if they would be in San Francisco, it would be so much easier. The truth is, you know, it sounds like that a lot of times, but the truth is you really need to find and identify what kind of value you're creating with the company, and what kind of people would be, you know, would feel like there's value in that for them, and how they relate to it. I was talking to one of our investors today, and he was telling me, you know, one of the funny things that we did with raising our fund in Mexico was really bringing a lot of people into the VC world that weren't from the VC world. So there were a lot of these people, you know, very traditional businessmen that we had to sort of convince that there was value in what we're doing. Mainly because of just, you know, ignorance that they didn't know about this world. And this guy was telling me today, you know, like, oh, I hate not a tech world. You know, like, all these people, they're selling me these crazy ideas that everything's just going to be worth millions. And, you know, I mean, it doesn't happen. Well, you know, the thing is, you got to make sure that you understand that this is a hard industry. And so, honestly, if I would have to give you a personal piece of advice, it definitely had to be with, you know, setting the right expectations and really, you know, not trying to think that because you have a startup that's going to make millions of dollars, but actually try to see where you're at that very specific point in time and what you've done so far, and try to translate that into the learnings that you can share with the right people. So if you find people that feel incentivized to dig a little bit deeper in those learnings and share a little bit of that back with you, you're gonna find the right partners and you're gonna find the right investors. So I'll probably start by really understanding what you've accomplished, what you've learned, and who are the people who would make a good fit with that. I was talking to another one of our investors, considering a friend now, a couple of days back here as well, different angle. And he was like, I'm trying to understand my different investment strategies, and I still want to invest in tech, but it's so hard. There are all these different options. I'm like, well, think of this, and this is very different to, from funds to angel investors and different people, but my approach to him as an angel investor was like, think of the stuff that, this came out of Tim Ferriss' podcast, but he was actually saying, think of the kind of stuff that you, no matter what the outcome is, you're gonna come on top, right? So even if I lose all my money, I'm gonna invest in something that I've learned a ton or that I'm actually love to participate. So it really depends on what stage you are. Try to find those people first, because those are the kind of people that will sort of help us being the setting stone so you can go in for more. And then try to find the right VCs. There's a lot of information from those VCs, what investments they've done, what kind of strategies they have, what's their thesis. Try to find the people who just, they would inevitably invest in your company, not just because.
Yes.
Hi, I'm pretty loud. So I just got back and I spoke at Lopez, the Hispanic social media conference, and I was invited to speak on building the pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think this is what's working. Okay.
You said you were going to be very loud, so we don't have a problem.
Okay. So I'm building the pipeline. So I happen to work with girls living under the federal poverty level, their families. I'd say the majority of them, almost 50%, don't have broadband at home. And we're trying to teach them coding and tech entrepreneurship. We don't want it. So here we are in DC, and we have all these mothers coming up to us to our panel. Where do we get people fit into a class? And where do we? So here in Miami, I think it's great. This ecosystem is emerging. And as you said, the lab is doing great work. Knight is doing great work. WeWork is doing great work. Building is awesome. But how do you reach out? How do you, when we're not teaching this at school, we're not teaching entrepreneurship at school, how do we connect the dots for the underrepresented communities that aren't coming here, that can't, don't feel comfortable, really? You just came from Mexico, spent time there. You've been in Brazil, Chile really isn't a good example because they started, Chile is amazing, extraordinary. It's part of their culture, the fabric of their government. They get, we're not the UK, where we're teaching, where it's mandatory to learn CS. How do you bridge that gap so this ecosystem becomes more equitable? Question.
Well, you're killing us. You used the how to bridge the gap, so you're touching the fiber there. I think, first of all, a big part of that sort of realizing what we're good at and what we're not, I think, still again, you can't really go against what we have, what happens here in the US in terms of access to opportunity. Even there's still a way to go in a couple of aspects as you're bringing it up. I think this is fascinating for everyone in terms of the capacity to access opportunity. I think that in a way, for this to actually happen at the level that you hope for it to happen, there's probably going to be a little bit more of a, there's got to be some more governmental support, because you got to build. I think that this goes to a sort of a larger discussion, which is, I think that the roles of government as we know them are shifting. I mean, you know, we shouldn't expect, at least, you know, we come from, or I come from a background where governments have failed in many ways. You know, when you look at health, when you look at education, when you look at even the food supply, we are underserved in every possible one of those aspects. And I do believe in a personal, you know, from a personal standpoint, that a lot of those areas will be covered by the private sector, not the government sector, in the short term, mid-term. Because it's, you know, it's becoming such a great opportunity to solve it. It's only natural that someone will come up and say, you know, I'm building the next one. And it happens now with education, it's probably one of the easiest ways to look at it. Now we, you know, when we've seen that, you know, there weren't enough schools in different parts of the world and people weren't even able to get to school, now we're seeing there are so many different platforms over technology that will enable you to study from wherever you are and you won't need to go to school. So even if the government has failed to build the road, you know, if we actually manage to get you internet, then you're going to be able to go to school. You know, you're going to be educated. And the same thing will happen with medicine. Eventually, medicine will come to you. You won't have to go to it. And so you won't have to be able to think of, you know, a system that will provide a healthy net for you. But rather, you know, we'll find a way to diagnose you over the air and then be able to treat you over the air. Because, you know, I think eventually we'll even be able to print our own medicines at home. But, you know, the truth is, I think that we'll get there in a shorter period of time through the private sector than the governmental sector. But the government will have to provide infrastructure for that. So the government will have to provide the internet. You know, if we don't have internet, how are we going to teach kids to code when they don't even know what to do with it? You know? So I do feel the pain. I don't think I have a right answer, but I do think that the answer is infrastructure.
Yeah, and just a final note, I mean, it's the I don't believe the government's the answer. I think it, you know, it is going to take a village and everybody working together. But even in the state of Florida, you know, the government just passed a law a year ago, went into effect in July, and middle school's gap in the state, you know, now is almost at 50%. So employers can't find employees with the skill sets they need because of the disruption, technological disruption. It would take two state budgets in the state of Florida, two, to train everybody and retrain.
Yeah, we gotta find you.
I'm not saying it's an answer, I think it's an important discussion.
A very good friend of mine and mentor started a platform now under the premise that not everyone needs to learn how to code. Not everyone will eventually learn it. So basically, he's empowering people to learn skills that would be complementary to it.
Yes.
That within months you can have a job. So you can be support for companies. You can pick up the phone. I mean, some people are willing to work at the call center. So you know, you can learn how to sell or you know, or be support in that. I don't know how to type stuff. How to do? So how to do a lot of different things that will become very useful to this universe. That will not require you to have the highest level of IQ, that will not require you to go to a high cost course, but will eventually empower you to be able to be a part of the system. And I think that that's the kind of mentality that we need. You know, I'm not saying we should be condemning people to be lesser or worse, but what I'm trying to say is we got to make sure that everyone has the right opportunity to do something in this new world that we're building. And, you know,
Thank you.
I have a question. First of all, Jason, Juan, thanks for taking your time tonight to do this. I think this is the first step to connecting all these dots, you know, down here at events like this.
Thanks so much.
My question is basically two parts. One, like in the portfolio of companies you have, like in 500 startups, how many of them, or just a rough estimate, were already generating revenue or had customers when they started the program?
Yeah, so
versus an idea, a startup, and we need to develop something first.
There are different answers to that question because we do programs in different places and then sort of the bar gets set in different levels.
Okay.
I can say that in the US the bar has gotten extremely high because you know there's so much competition, there's so many companies, and so suddenly companies are generating somewhere in the tens of thousands of dollars in revenue per month before they're coming in. In Mexico, I have to say that, you know, we've had companies with close to zero revenue, very rare, but close to zero, but, you know, great people behind them. So we knew right off the bat that, you know, it was people that we wanted to work with. Like, we have one of our, probably one of the best portfolio companies right now called 99 Minutos. The guy came in, like, he basically came in with a cold email, sent an email to us saying, you know, I got this this idea I want to talk to you about. And we were like, oh God, this is the worst start we could ever hope for. And suddenly, you know, he applies and he's basically renting hookahs for parties. Mm-hmm. And we're like, so we at that point we couldn't really connect it to the email. But then we said like, oh God. And then we looked a little bit further on the application, and the guy was saying that he would bring a hookah to your place within 99 minutes of you calling. Now bear in mind, this is Mexico City. I mean, wow. You guys think traffic is bad here? We live in Mexico City, is like dying while you're in traffic. I mean, it's just not working. So we couldn't believe that that was possible. So we decided we were going to try it. So we called, sort of, the day was sort of coming to an end, 6, 7 p.m., you know, sort of the commercial hours. And we called and we said, hey, you know, we would like to buy some tobacco. And we want, you know, mints and this and that, da, da, da. No, actually, they don't mind. They have the website. And so, you know, sometimes start, you know, the timer starts going, and suddenly the heavy rain starts pouring down in Mexico. We're like, oh, this guy's never gonna make it. Like, there's no way on earth. Like, 30 minutes go by, and we receive it. We're like, you know, this guy's just never gonna make it. We, you know, we're just laughing. And we receive a call. He's like, oh, hey, you call me from the Minutos, so I have to say we don't have mint. So we're not gonna send you mint. But we got these other flavors we're gonna be putting in there, and we're gonna give you a gift because we didn't have mint. Which they didn't even know it was us. So we were like, you know, happily impressed. Time keeps, you know, keeps going. Like, you know, after like an hour, suddenly ding dong, and then we're there with the liver. So we call the guy and we said, hey, you know, we'd like to talk to you. Come in. And like, hey, you know, we tried your service. We think this, there's a component which is impressive, and there's a component which is total crap. And they're like, you know, what are you talking about? I'm like, yeah, your business is crap. And he was like, so why am I here? And we were like, we want to make you a logistics company. So if you're okay with becoming a company that could send anything within 99 minutes in the city, we'd like for you to support our e-commerce portfolio. So all of a sudden you have a company in Mexico making deliveries of e-commerce, for e-commerce, within 99 minutes. And so suddenly it's integrated to companies where you can buy online on the e-commerce side. Within 99 minutes, the product is there. Suddenly there's no questions about whether e-commerce is reliable or not. You can pay cash when the delivery comes in. You know this is great. You're in a country that no one really relies on this kind of service where you buy online. Suddenly everyone's blown away. And suddenly we're moving that into actually having warehouses where we can actually become hubs for them, for e-commerces to actually give them all the inventory, put it in there, and they take care of the whole thing. We start doing that in different warehouses in different parts of Mexico. So that not only you buy from this guy's, you know, you're buying from this guy's from Monterrey, it doesn't matter whether the company's in Mexico City, they'll send it from their warehouse in Monterrey. And it's mind blowing. That doesn't happen here in the US, right? Amazon is now trying a couple of things, but it doesn't happen. So these guys are doing it in Mexico. And that happened with no revenue. Like, they didn't even have that business when they started with us.
But that was an idea of a service that you guys took it, you know, you looked at and then came up with a model that you thought would work, or he came to you and said, hey, I don't know where this is gonna go.
No. The guy thought that what he was doing was going in the right direction. The hookah thing. But I have to say, nonetheless, that the guy is one of the best founders we have. Like, you know, the guy is full on operations. He is managing this incredible operation. So it's not just, oh, we were great, and we actually turned it. We just saw an opportunity and actually managed to convince him that it was the greatest opportunity he could pursue. But it was all his work, right? It's an amazing company.
So, real quickly, what do you feel about crowdfunding for entrepreneurs, people have an idea before they go to angels and try to raise money?
Again, there are many ways to fund a company. not VC is not the answer for everyone, not the answer for everything. The most important component, when I look at VC, crowdfunding right now, I actually look at a great way to validate demand. And it's extremely valid and it's extremely useful. You know, if I have a company selling a product or selling hardware, for instance, it's a great way to come to a VC and say, hey, you know what, it just validated this thing is wanted by X amount of people. I wouldn't use it as a crowdfunding per se, but actually it's a way to validate that.
Cool. Thank you.
One more question?
Maybe a curveball, maybe you feel uncomfortable about something. Anyone feeling that, you know, they need the money back? Hey.
Okay,
he's got questions. Yeah, oh God, I was sweating. I didn't know how much you paid, you know? I'm hoping you got a discount coupon or something, you know?
I just got 6 months. Well, kind of two questions. One, what exactly is your role in the company? What exactly do you do?
Mm-hmm.
What exactly do you do?
No, the second question.
So the second question is, based on all that you told us just in the history, if you had to do anything differently, what would you do differently? If you had to go back, doing what you know now, and where you came from, and where you are right now, what would you do differently? And what is your vision, in one sentence, what is your vision for the future, and what you do right now? So there's a few questions.
So, first question, I'm an investment partner. So, I've been the last couple of years running the Mexican accelerator, sort of going through the process of understanding what we can do better, bringing more companies in, finding more companies in different countries, and making a lot of, you know, together with your partners, sort of working throughout those investment decisions. Now I'm here in Miami, we're running a program downstairs for whoever doesn't know, you know, it's a 2 month program with 8 companies that we brought in, 5 companies from that time, 2 companies from Miami, a company from San Francisco, and sort of Brazil. We working with them for 2 months to help them grow their customer acquisition, you know, paid customer acquisition. So basically helping companies bring more money. And it's been working incredibly good. A couple of, you know, there's a founder back there that's actually a part of the process, so you can get to meet him. Daniel. Daniel! Yeah. See, that's the kind of support I get from these guys. Yeah. Imagine, you know what, we are one of the main investors of this guy, he doesn't even care about the whole talk. Yeah, so this guy, is from a company called Rocket. He's Colombian, very dodgy. Now living in Mexico, you know, they're sort of building the next credit card for that time, building, you know, understanding the whole notion behind credit scoring, trying to find a way to integrate within the financial world, people who are actually now out of the system. So they found a great opportunity within Mexico, you know, where like 75% of the people are outside of banking, and you know, he's allowing them to find their own financial products. So this guy, you know, they were actually in the accelerator in Mexico City, so he can even, you know, he can tell you whether we've been shit or not. And he's actually now doing pretty good here. Within a couple of weeks, I think they were doing 10x sort of the results in their company. So, you know, please feel free to come to Daniel after this and, you know, ask him questions about us and what he's doing and what kind of things you can do even. And so, did I answer any other questions?
So as the funding partner, are you really focused on helping companies find their funding?
So we help companies with sort of understanding, you know, how to fundraise and who to go for. A lot of times we make introductions and we help them sort of go through the subsequent rounds with our support, with our networks. And unfortunately enough, you know, we built a great brand so that people recognize that there's usually good value to companies that we, you know, we sort of work with.
What's your biggest mistake?
What would you do differently?
Honestly, you know, as far as it can sound cliche, I think I did a lot of mistakes, but I think they were all great towards being here. So I wouldn't probably change them, because otherwise I would have to change what I'm right now. And I think that, you know, as Steve Jobs used to say, you sort of, you know, you find how to join those dots looking backwards, not looking forwards. And now everything I've done, for better or for worse, makes sense. And then the vision for the future, you know, I'm probably going to become an entrepreneur very soon again. I think that that's probably where I can go back to making a dent for myself. I think that it's been a great path to helping other people become their own desires of what they want to be. And I think I wanted to do something a little bit more for myself and be able to have my own band as well. And I think, you know, I've had this incredible luck of being able to work with all these companies and knowing all these people and having all this knowledge and, you know, fortunately not being able to learn what they made mistakes. So, you know, it's like having all the good stuff. So, yeah.
One last question. The statistics are that most startups will fail within 5 years. When you're developing a startup, what exactly do you look for to determine whether they'll be successful?
A lot of the times because we know that most of them will fail, we don't really look at what they want to be. Because most of the times it's going to be bullshit.
Especially
that
early on.
Yeah, that early on, it's very hard, right? Like, they all come to you and saying that they're going to be making millions. And he's like, so how much are you making now? 25 cents. So it sounds stupid, right? Like, you know, it's nothing you can. But what you want to do is actually look at the kind of problem they're trying to solve. What's their unique point of view about the problem? What gives them an unfair advantage to tackle the problem in a very specific way? And particularly important is what they've actually managed to accomplish until today, right? So they started off with an idea or something they wanted to solve. What have they done so far? And if you see that, a lot of times it actually speaks much more of their capacity to execute other than their capacity to dream. We can all dream. You know, we wake up and suddenly, you know, we're in this beautiful island and, you know, this self-wishing and it's all really great. The truth is, you know, you gotta come down to earth and see what you've done and how much you care about actually solving something that's real. And I think that when we look at this motto, the majority of startups will fail as well. We're measuring them to fail against this unique mentality. When we look at companies and we say the majority will fail, it's not necessarily the reason. But probably most of them won't reach the level that we would expect them to reach. But if we find people who are actually talented and doing stuff every day, a lot of those startups will work in a way.
And you mentioned, we'll come back to you.
Oh, sir.
One second. Just to wrap up on this talk real quick. You mentioned looking at their achievements to date. So do you kind of, in your head, do an equation of achievements divided by time and see how much you've accomplished?
In a bit. You want to see that they've been able to do something interesting, something that has taught them well, has taught them things that could sort of potentiate what can happen later in time. You want to see that they've been able to get there by their own means. Like, you know, sometimes you have someone coming and saying, hey, I got this great idea, I want your money to build it. It sounds weird, right? I would rather have someone coming and say, hey, I found this great problem, we managed to build this, you know, kind of crappy product, but it's actually been working, and people are actually finding that they want to pay for it because it actually solves a big part of the problem. And so we managed to actually understand through that little iteration that there was something useful in what we thought that we might have been a solution. And so we built on it, you know, we got this other guy who came, joined the team, and he started building the product. And now we have this, you know, product that looks a little bit better. It's generating something because we found that there might be some product to fit. And so we might want to say, let's put some money in it to see whether that's something that can grow to a certain stage. And if that happens, then, you know, it makes a lot more sense. Because you see that we're both compromising. We're both giving in
something. Gotcha. Okay. Well, no, that's fine. I was going to ask you, for example, with some...
Great voice,
huh? Yeah. With some projects, you basically have some entrepreneurs that prefer to, you know, focus on making, you know, a little bit of headway in smaller projects, while others prefer to risk and bet for larger projects, making strides, but still taking a little bit longer to get there. What do you guys prefer? I mean, do you guys prefer?
For us, you know, venture capital goes for the large things, you know, large bet, you know, large gambles, because it's all about generating those large returns in a few of those companies.
But many times it takes longer to show the results.
Usually venture capital funds are 10-year funds. It's funds that really don't really look for dividends or something that will generate, liquidity, in a sort of a repetitive way, but rather something that we would go in and get out of it with the entrepreneur within that 10-year period. So ultimately, what I'm trying to say is that you are sort of obliged to invest in like markets that are sort of at least a billion dollars, and that are large enough. The problem is large enough. Blah, 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 blah. But that's venture capital. And again, I think we sort of talked about this. It's not the only way. If you don't have that idea, it's fine as well, right? It's not like, I'm a lawyer, so I'm not really tapping into that kind of a market. So then I'm a failure. Whatever I'm doing, it's not right. It's just that if you want to be in a startup as an entrepreneur that wants to go and raise venture capital money, you need to know that's a game you like.
Yeah, I think that if you were to start a company, you'd probably go for the small iterations, improving things out over time, and not so much playing on the long-term possibilities.
So until you find something that will generate what the game is asking from you, it doesn't really make sense to do anything else. I think there's a lot of people wanting to start companies that just because they read in a blog post that they need to go and raise money, that's what they're going for, and usually it's not necessarily the answer. When you start doing the math, sorry, I'm reading from your notes. We're gonna be done soon. So, if you do the math, when you ask for investment, you need to make sure you understand what the math not only for you is, but what's the math for the investor? A lot of these investors, I'm out of here. A lot of these investors need to make 50x out of your investment, 60x. And unless you can do that, you shouldn't ask for them money. You shouldn't ask them for money. If you come and say, no, but you should be, you should be grateful, you should be, we're talking about WeWork. Right. There we go, WeWork in building, fantastic, welcome. And so, when you look at the math and you come to your investor and say, hey, I just made you 3x, why are you upset? And you don't understand why that might be upsetting, it's your problem, not the VC's, right? Because the VC model doesn't work like that. So you need to understand what the game dynamics sort of ask for before you come into the game. There's a great book by Brad Feld called Venture Deals that explains a great deal of these things, and it explains sort of the more basic stuff. Everyone that needs to deal with a lawyer, I'm always saying, hey, before you go and talk to your lawyer, read Venture Deal, because you'll understand what the lawyer's gonna talk to you about. But it's great because it explains what the dynamics of an angel investor is and what the dynamics of a venture capital fund is. And so if you understand the game, it's fine that you play. If you don't understand the game, it doesn't make sense. So, again, if I would start a company, unless I would understand that I'm having something that could generate enough returns for the investor, I wouldn't go, because I would be sort of coming with a totally wrong approach to a game that's just doomed for failure.
Could you say more about the 2 months program? What kind of companies are you looking at, if there is any investment?
Yeah, so we've invested up to 250K in each one of these companies. It's companies that we didn't have an open application, but rather we find them through referrals or people that we know that were already within our network. It's companies that not only were a great investment, but at the same time were companies that we knew exactly that we could help the customer acquisition. So we knew we would come in right off the bat, have a very good impact in the company. So we actually had a great team within 500, but that's all this, so we call it distribution. So it's this distribution layer where we can help companies reach more customers and make more money, ultimately. And so we built this through different iterations throughout time. Last year we started off in Malaysia with a program. We did this year another one in Malaysia, one in London, and we're doing this one here. So it's like pop-up programs that we have in different parts of the world where we can actually come and bring companies together and help them grow.
So it's not there isn't any way to apply it, I need to be
Yeah, you just need to be narrator.
these companies, were these companies part of Accelerator?
Different. So out of the eight companies that we brought in here, four companies have already received investment from us.
Okay.
And four companies have come sort of from different paths, different ways. Plush Prep, you know, one of the companies that you mentioned is supporting us here today. I'm here to see why I'm here. Thanks, Plush Prep. and they're doing amazing stuff out of here in Miami.
Yeah.
And we actually met them through the building.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's one of those things, you know, you're sort of connected to the network, and suddenly, you know, you get a person referral coming in. It's a great way to get investment from anyone, not just from us, from anyone. If you can get a referral, it's much easier. Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much, Juan.